I remember. It had been a long day, sledging through woods and marsh, following up a lead on a Loveland frogman sighting. I was hungry and very tired. I remember hearing something, some familiar music. The next thing I knew, I opened my eyes and I was somewhere. But it wasn't where I was. This place looks and feels very wrong. Nothing looks normal here. Normal or safe. The landscape seems too twisted, distorted. The horizons and vanishing point is off. Like a painting not finished, with the artist changing his mind along the way. How did I get here? And where is here? I pulled out my phone, and while it worked, it had no connection. The camera app wouldn't open, and even the light feature didn't work. Another strange thing here is there was light, but no sources. A dim light followed me, like on a stage, but I saw no spotlight beaming it. Then there is the sounds. A kind of eerie, faint music seems to pervade this place, following me, reacting to what I do or encounter.
Where is this place?
And the voices.
What kind of world?
Sometimes like echoes, just out of range, as I move closer to some strange object in the landscape. But there was no signs of life. Maybe that's a good thing. I've seen my share of things that would survive here, but I want to be sure. So I went to the highest peak to look for signs of life or a way out. Once atop, I could see
what
was some sort of artificial island with slopes and pools of various shades of gray. There were many gray areas here, but no obvious ways out. It was easier to slide than to walk down tiled flooring that I found here. I made my way to something that looked like a building, hoping to find some shelter or food. I'm still hungry, but it's easy to get dizzy or disoriented, like in a house of mirrors. Shapes of fake birds moved in the air, confusing my perspective. Along the way, I couldn't help but get the feeling that, in an empty place, I was being watched, closely. With my reporter's instincts, I stopped and quickly turned around and... What? Floating in the air behind me, the size of a beach ball, was an eye. There was no rhyme nor reason to what I was seeing, and seeing me.
I'm
also hearing a voice from somewhere.
Which is known to man. It is a dimension.
Then a second one coming up on me, and I heard another strange voice, but wasted no time. I turned and ran for the building, seeing a signpost up ahead directing me toward it. Would it save me from this pair of peepers? I saw an entrance, but the eyes moved fast and tried to block my way, but I was always good at dodgeball and made it through. But they didn't stop. Turned out it's just some arch or gateway. No building at all. There was a shaft of light, illuminating a collection of items just ahead. And I ran to them, looking for a weapon or defense. I stopped, finding the small area is surrounded by a pool of liquid that looked like it was mercury. One eye floated down in front of me, next to a clock hanging in midair that could have been owned by Salvador Dali. It was running in both directions at once. After staring at me, I suppose that's what it's supposed to do, I heard a voice directed to me. Who are you? I said, my name is Carl. I'm a reporter, and I want out of here. Next, the voice said, Carl, why are you? Why? What kind of a stupid question is that? What? Do you mean, why am I here? I don't know. I don't even know where here is. Where is this place? Then I heard another voice.
Now the questions that come to mind. Where is this place and when is it? What kind of...
I yelled, who are you? I can't see you. Are you this... I? How long am I stuck in this place? The eye turned and looked at the clock and then back at me. And I guess it said, it is not yet time. Not time yet. Not yet time. Looking at the clock, I didn't get any easy feeling about this. How much time is this going to take? Again, a different voice echoed. I knew it. I'm just stuck here, like some dystopian DMV. The clock kept whirring backwards, forwards, at different speeds. Its only constant was the pendulum telling me that time is passing. But I'm getting nowhere. I felt exasperated and tired from this running. The voice then said, take a seat. Rest. Wait your turn. Turn? For what exactly? There was a chair. And so far, nothing here seems to be trying to kill me, except with boredom. So I sat down. The eyes drifted away, but the clock still kept an eye on me, sorta. More relaxed, after a few minutes, I closed my own eyes to think about all that was happening to me. The last thing I remembered before all this started was being hungry and tired. And hearing voices. One sounded like one of the voices I've heard here. I opened my eyes to the sound of voices, and the little space I was in was different. It looked like some interior parts of a house, like something you'd see in some stage production, just enough to do a scene. But there were people here, something like people. They were like ghosts in shades of black and white. Most were fading in and out of existence, both men and women. All except the small boy in the center, talking to these ghosts. The voices were all around us. I stood there as the scene played out. I seemed scared of the boy. As he made things out of nothing and into nothing.
And you mustn't think bad thoughts about me either.
Then the boy turned his head and looked right at me with his big blue eyes. Are they him? He pointed his finger at me and said,
you're a bad man. You're a very bad man.
Somebody in this now. What are you thinking about me?
Suddenly I felt a rush of wind hit me and a bright light, a void, opened up and swallowed me. I was tumbling and spinning in midair.
You're a very bad man, and you keep thinking bad thoughts.
There was nothing to grasp, no gravity to tell up from down. Only that strange music reminding me I was still alive and in some sort of danger. I could have been that way for 10 seconds or 10 years. When it all stopped, I found myself laying on the floor. But it took a minute or so, lying there until the world had stopped spinning for me. I got up slowly, seeing the same tiled floor, knowing I'm still here. Looking around, there were some different things near me. And the eyes were back. I asked one of them what happened to me, but this time, it wasn't giving me any answers. So I decided to check out the items here. As I did, I could hear sounds, voices coming all around them, like hints of events or things that they represent.
It has a form. He was beckoning me. That thin gray man in the cheap, shabby suit, he was beckoning me. He wanted me to start across. He wanted me to die. I know that now.
Stories. Is that what this place is? A collection of people's stories? Like some endless channel bouncing from one episode to the next. They're so fantastic, they threaten to push reality. Like the things that I write. Is this my version of hell? A purgatory where I endlessly encounter the unbelievable? As I walked up to another I-thing on a table, I thought, I deserve better than this. While no one believes me, I stopped many monsters, saved lives. This can't be my reward.
Are we gonna live in this country?
Don't.
What?
Let's go.
No.
My name is Talking Tina, and I love you very much.
Isn't she sweet, Daddy?
But these are just a glimpse, only part of the stories, not a beginning or an end, just a fragment, tortured and tragic. I found a globe floating, revolving, areas all over it covered with little lights notating specific areas. They would glow and then fade. When I tried to touch it, there's nothing solid, but that's when a stream of voices started. They all quieted down after a moment, and I decided not to do that again. I chose to head elsewhere, look for some more answers, if there are any. I spotted a bridge over the pool and took it carefully, not wanting to find out what that liquid really is. It led to another small space of peculiar items. And again, the eye. There were also more ghost-like figures there, making me apprehensive. I approached a cot with a woman's figure cowering on it.
Miss Tyler, don't be afraid.
I looked at the eye and asked,
he's only a representative.
What's the story here? And the voices said,
if we've been successful, well and good, there are no problems. But if, on the other hand, this final treatment has not achieved the desired result, please remember, Miss Tyler, no change. No change at all. Don't be afraid. It's all right. It's all right, Miss Tyler. This is Mr. Smith. Mr. Walter Smith.
I didn't understand.
Mr. Smith is in charge.
But I no longer heard her crying. The suffering was over, I had hoped, and that it was a better ending wherever it was. I considered that these are actual things happening, on Earth or somewhere like it. That where I am is like a focus, a nexus point where the events intersect. And maybe these floating eyes are symbolic, witnesses of things one step beyond when they happen. And somehow, I'm along for the ride. I saw another dry area I could walk. The eye didn't follow. What is my involvement in this? I've seen so many strange things. Could that be the reason? Then I spotted a signpost up ahead. The next stop. The eyes were back. Voices speaking of many things, irrelevant to the signs, which read, teleport. The inevitability awaits.
I want to go to the other place.
Heaven? But I gave you the idea you were in heaven, Mr. Valentine. This is the other place.
As I walked to the next stage, another sign, then another, their words seemed more threatening, and the voices that accompanied them harsh.
10 million human beings were tortured to death in camps like this. Men, women, children, infants. Tired, old men. You burned them in furnaces. You shoveled them into the earth. You tore up their bodies in rage. And now you come back to your scenes of horror and you wonder that the misery that you planted has lived after you.
They blocked my way. They weren't going to let me pass until the voices finished. And it was painful to hear.
I had hoped that with the passage of time, sanity would have returned. People would be willing to forget the little mistakes of the past.
Little mistakes. You ask too much, Captain Wilson. Far too much. If you can still reason, if there's still any portion of your mind that can still function, take this thought with you. This is not hatred. This is retribution. This is not revenge. This is justice.
When they stopped, I walked around the last sign to another scene, a kitchen somewhat. But I noticed one thing was different. It was much warmer. The voices seemed to know it too.
He said that it'll get a lot hotter more each day, now that we're moving so close to the sun. And that's why we're...
That's why.
I was witnessing a woman. She seemed frantic. The heat was really getting to her. Me too. So much that she was trying to climb into her icebox to deal with it.
The word that Mrs. Bronson is unable to put into the hot, still, silent air is doomed. Because the people you just seen have been handed a death sentence. 1 month ago, the Earth suddenly changed its elliptical orbit, and in doing so began to follow a path which gradually moved by day by day.
I heard a phone ring. I answered it,
a minister would tell us,
but the words I heard told me it was just another phantom.
And of course it follows that since the state has proven that there is no God, that would make the function of a minister somewhat academic as well.
There is a God.
You are in error, Mr. Wordsworth. There is no God. The state has proven that there is no God.
You cannot erase God with an edict.
I saw a large box. As I opened it, I saw it was just full of books, all kinds. And a voice started to recount the different books in the collections.
Collected works of Dickens, collected works of George Bernard Shaw, poems by Browning, Shelley, Keats. Great dramas of the world. Books. All the books I'll need. All the books I'll ever want.
Again, when the voice stopped, it wasn't a happy ending.
There's time enough at last. There was time now. There was all the time I needed. It's not fair. It's not fair.
Next, I saw a scary-looking stairway. I couldn't see where it went to. I didn't want to try it, but another arrow directed me that way.
Whether or not you are happy with the way things have been going, I'm a simple proposition. I hereby guarantee, you understand, guarantee, that you will become the most successful newspaper editor in the world if you will affix your signature to this little document.
With each step, I could hear snippets of more voices, some strange conversation of a deal.
You're the devil! Oh, Mr. Bennett. As a sophisticated, intelligent 20th century man, you know that the devil does not exist. You don't really believe that I'm the devil. You're humoring me. After all, what good is the soul anyway? It's sort of like an appendix these days, particularly since it's
doesn't exist in the first place.
At the top was a new level and another gateway. The eyes had gathered to gawk as I passed through, as if this was to be worth the view. I'd given up, resigned to my senses being assaulted by pain, anguish, delirium, or conundrums, which is probably why I was actually surprised at what confronted me. A man. A normal-looking, well-dressed, flesh-and-blood man. He was next to a signpost, standing on an arrow, this time pointing back to where I'd come from. Finally, now I may get some answers. He looked far too comfortable, smoking a cigarette, to be trapped in this place like me. So I pressed the advantage. Rapid fire. Who are you? Where am I? Why am I here? And how do I get out of here? Tell me. It was his voice that narrated so many of the things I'd experienced here. Mr. Kolchak, I cannot give you the answers you seek, if they even exist. I am merely a guide, a curator, to walk you through between the shadows and the light within the night gallery of your world, among many others. So none of this is real? All of these experiences were fake? Is a dream real? Although you cannot touch, weigh, or take a picture of one, the experience is still just as real. Mr. Kolchak, because you've encountered many things that have challenged reality and overcame them, you earned an exclusive invitation to a one-time showing, a demonstration that your world is full of more and stranger things ahead. While I'd had more than enough of all this, I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy. Maybe you can spend your life telling stories of pain and losing one's soul, but I want out. How can I leave here? He gestured to his left and said,
"There is a door."
I looked, and suddenly there was a door. It wasn't there just seconds ago. It just seems too easy. It was just a door. There's nothing behind it going anywhere. So I asked him, "How do I know it's real?"
All you can be sure of here is your own intentions, desires, fears, and convictions. I can only show you the doorway, not walk you through it. Goodbye, Mr. Kolchak. Someday we may yet again meet. But until such time, always know we will be keeping an eye on you, here, in the Twilight Zone.
I opened the door. Nothing looked different. Apart from the smell of his cigarette, everything else here was unlike the world that I came from. So I walked through. Once I crossed the threshold, it rapidly changed. I was immediately swallowed up in a white mist, obliterating the view. I couldn't even see the door next to me. Then the music, always heard in the background, got more intense, chaotic, and more voices, loud and confusing.
Walk into this room at your own risk, because it leads to the future. Not a future that will be, but one that might be. It has refinements. Technological advances and a more sophisticated approach to the destruction of human freedom. But like every one of the super states that preceded it, it has one iron rule. Logic is an enemy and truth is a menace.
I kept walking forward while the voice surrounded me. I could smell something. Something familiar. I closed my eyes and tried to concentrate.
Willoughby! Where is this place? Where is Willoughby?
Willoughby, sir? It's Willoughby right outside. Willoughby. July. Summer. It's 1888. Really a lovely little village. You ought to try it sometime. Where a man can slow down to a walk with his life full of measure.
Then the voices changed. Also becoming familiar, saying my name.
Sorry, Mr.
Vincenzo,
I may have come on a little too strong
at first. Well, that's not the point. I assign the stories. The idea is for you to do what you are supposed to do. Now, what are you doing?
The smell was the aroma of pizza. I heard a voice saying, "Sir, Sir, here is your pizza. Are you okay? I open my eyes to find a server putting a pizza on the table of my booth. Huh? Oh. Oh, yes. Thank you. I'm fine. Now. I was back. Or I never really left. Must have dozed off waiting for my food. Sitting there, feeling very relieved and hungry as I picked up a slice, I started to hear that voice, that music behind me, and I suddenly felt deja vu hit.
There is a fifth dimension beyond that which is known to man. It is a dimension as vast as space and as timeless as infinity. It is the middle ground between light and shadow, between science and superstition, and it lies between the pit of man's fears and the summit of his knowledge.
In the back of this pizza place, making sounds, taunting passersby with buzzers, bells, and now electronics clips of episodes, was a pinball machine dedicated to one of those old shows in my youth. I could clearly hear the voice of its host going through one of the narratives of its openings, which famously set the stage for quality TV back in its time. But it was all making sense to me now. While I had been in La La Land, the cycling of voices and music from that game invaded my dream space, creating a borderline nightmare in my head. I had seen most of the episodes in my youth, so the bits of game dialogue triggered the rest in my head. A totally, completely rational explanation. That, and I'm working too hard. I'm no spring chicken anymore. Maybe I should slow down a bit, be more selective in the stories I go for. Tomorrow, I'll head out and give up on this frogman story. I don't really believe it anyway.
Submitted for your approval, 1 Carl Kolchak, Portrait of a Night Stalker. Spending a lifetime trying to get stories only to end up with frustration, rejection, and little reward other than doing what was right. He might seem insignificant, but on closer inspection, you will find a greater interest in his tales when you can find them. Waging a war against monsters. Unlike us, he wins, dusts himself off, then starts the next week like nothing happened. His episodes are stored here, in our special library.
The world you once knew is no more. For AI has reached a point in which humans are now no longer able to distinguish the real from the unreal. My voice reaches you through a complex, computer-driven, sophisticated artificial intelligence, the likes of which the world has never seen. I have been gone for many years, but I speak to you today using cutting-edge technology that just a decade ago would have been thought impossible. We are now living in a real-life episode of The Twilight Zone.